It must have been an amazing sight. John said, and then I saw a new heaven and a new earth coming down out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. We're going to think today about the end. We're going into the last 3 weeks of the church year, and so we think about end times. And we want to think today about the hope that we have as Christians in the promise of the resurrection. It's a lot like a wedding banquet. So I pray God's blessings on us in our time of service today. I do want to say, and I'll say this, welcome to the people watching on YouTube. We've changed some formats, and we're changing our schedule a little bit. I do want to say thank you for wearing the masks, and I'd ask that you would keep those on during the entire service. You know, there's been an uptick in things, and we want to be good neighbors and keep one another safe. So thank you for wearing those masks in our time of worship. Let's rise now and begin with the first hymn.
Begin our worship this morning. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
God shows his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we've now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Rejoice then in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we've now received reconciliation. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, send forth your Son to lead home his bride, the church, that with all the company of the redeemed, we may finally enter into his eternal wedding feast. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Well, today is the anniversary of St. Luke's founding, and our responsive reading will be a special anniversary responsive reading. We give thanks to God for the blessing of our congregational life. We give thanks to God for his work among us through his word and sacraments. Seek your blessing, O Lord. Grant us guidance and protection in this new year of ministry at St. Luke Lutheran Church, one congregation in two locations. We pray that Jesus' gospel message will be proclaimed in our midst faithfully and powerfully. We pray that our shared congregational life will be characterized by unity, joy, and zeal to shine a brighter light into the darkened world. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning,
is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Congregation may be seated as we now hear God's word.
Hello from the Sestak family. The first reading is from Amos, chapter 5, beginning with the 18th verse. Woe to you who desire the day of the Lord. Why would you have the day of the Lord? It is darkness and not light, as if a man fled from a lion and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned his hand against the wall and a serpent bit him. Is not the day of the Lord darkness and not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I hate, I despise your feasts, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the peace offerings of your fattened animals, I will not look upon them. Take away from me the noise of your songs. To the melody of your harps, I will not listen. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream.
This is the word of the Lord.
The second lesson is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning with the 14th verse. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by the word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
This is the word of the Lord. We miss you.
We love you.
And we'll see you soon.
That's pretty cool, huh? I invite the congregation to please rise for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. The 25th chapter. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves." And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered, "Truly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." This is the gospel of our Lord. The congregation may be seated as we now hear the children's message.
Good morning, and how are you all doing today? I'd say it's nice to see your bright and smiling faces, but I'm going to have to imagine that I see them this morning, and that's okay. You know, I heard a story about a little puppy that noticed that whenever he was happy, his tail wagged. So he thought he had found the secret to happiness. One day he shared the secret of happiness with an older dog, and he said, "I have learned that the best thing for a dog is happiness. And that happiness is in my tail. So I'm going to chase my tail, and when I catch it, I shall have happiness." The old dog thought about that and replied, "I too believe that happiness is a marvelous thing for a dog, and that happiness is in my tail. But I have noticed that when I chase it, my tail keeps running away from me. But when I go about my business, it follows me wherever I go. There are many things in my life that I am happy about and grateful for. I'm happy, I would say even blessed, to have wonderful parents that have taught me throughout my life. I learned to get along with people because of my brothers and sister. I had the opportunity to go to church and school to learn about God and the world. I was blessed with the opportunity to have family and spend time with my family to teach and learn. I learned selflessness because the need of others was greater than mine. These things made me happy and brought me joy. If you look at 1 Thessalonians 5:18, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Let's start off with the word circumstance. How did the definition on that one go? A fact or event that affects a situation, a fact or condition connected with a relevant event or action. Got it? Okay, let's try another way. Let's say a fact. Let's imagine that today is your birthday. What's the relevant event or action that follows that? Well, if it's your birthday, then it's going to be a birthday party, spend time with your friends, and you have presents. Let's say a condition. Let's say you're under the weather. What's the event or action? You're not going outside to play and have a good time. Thanksgiving. A fact? Well, we get together with people, we give thanks for the things we've had, and we have a lot of food. Christmas Day, we celebrate the perfect gift to the human race, which is Jesus Christ. Now, I wrestled a little bit back in the day, and one Saturday we had an international tournament. The team won overall, I won my weight class, and was MVP. It was a long day, and some family and friends had made it to watch, but no one was around to give me a ride home at the end of the day. So guess what? I got to walk home. I learned a very valuable lesson that day. Stay humble and don't get a puffed up head. I was happy with my victory, but remember to give thanks in a good situation helps us remember that God, who gave us the very best gift in Jesus, also gives us every other good thing. We give thanks to God when good things happen because we need to be reminded that he is the giver of all things. Can we fold our hands and say a prayer? Dear Lord, thank you for your gift and talents, or thank you for our gifts and talents. They come from you and they belong to you. We have happiness because of your love for us and the blessings you give us. May we continue to give you all of the credit and praise. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you all very much. Have an excellent day.
Thank you for that children's message. Our service continues now with our sermon hymn.
I had kind of an interesting experience this last week on Thursday. I was on my way into church, that's men's Bible study. By the way, if there are any guys who want to be part of the men's Bible study on Thursday morning, let me know. We'll get you connected in. So I was driving into church for the Bible study at 7 in the morning, and it was kind of interesting. As I was driving down Tyhart just back here, I looked, and off to the east, the sun was coming up. You know, it's been one of those weeks. The election has been all in disarray. We finally come to a conclusion. We've had an uptick in the virus that's been going on. People are concerned about the problems and the troubles in the world, in their lives, in the community. But sure enough, the sun came up. And if anybody's watching on, or those that are watching on YouTube, if you haven't been outside, I'm here to report the sun came up again today. And that's how it is. You know, the sun comes up day after day. Here it is, a new day has dawned. The world did not come to an end, but it will. That's what we want to think about these next few weeks. The world goes round and round, up and down, on and on. But there will come a day that the world comes to an end. There are three general views about human existence, life. We might say one is more of an Eastern mysticism view of life, that the wheel of life, that life just goes on and on, around and round, and something will always come next. Another worldview would be, maybe we call it the progressive worldview, and I don't mean politically progressive. I'm not talking about that. Hold on out there. How's that? Thank you. The progressive worldview, and I don't mean politically left or right, but that idea that there will always be a thing of progress, and that today will always be better than yesterday, tomorrow will be better yet, and that things are on a path to only get better and better, and as long as we don't pollute ourselves out of existence, life will go on, and in fact, if human beings put their mind to it, we may be able to break the power of death altogether because of human progress. And then there's the Christian. And that is that we are indeed progressing, and there are some ups and downs, but that history is progressing to an end. That this world will come to an end, this world as we know it, but that God promises a new heaven and a new earth. That's what we want to look at today and over the next few weeks. We're at the end of the church year, and we traditionally look at the end of time and the hope of everlasting life. Today, as we look at Matthew chapter 25, toward the end, we're going to see three things. The first is that patience is to be our watchword. I don't know what your emotion is. I don't know what your mindset is today, but the Christian mindset is always to be patient. We want to see that a banquet begins at the end. This sermon is not doom and gloom. This sermon is promise and great expectation. And then the third thing that we'll see today is that a well-oiled life survives the end. Let's pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, come be with us, your people, as we spend time in worship today. Either in the sanctuary or virtually through YouTube or other platforms. Thank you for the technology that keeps us connected one to another, but also especially connected to you through the power of your word. Come teach us and lead us and make us prepared. Help us to be patient, not giving in to discouragement, not giving in to too much hope about this world, but that our hope would always be in Jesus, in the new heaven and the new earth that he brings. Guide us for Jesus' sake. Amen. Well, like I said, this is the third last week of the church year. Over the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at the end, which is really a new beginning. And we'll be looking at Matthew chapter 25. Jesus was teaching about the end of the world. This all took place on, it looks like, Tuesday of Holy Week. If you go back and look at Matthew chapter 24, it says, "Now Jesus left the temple and was going away with it when his disciples came to point out to him the buildings of the temple." Say, "Hey, Jesus, look at these things. Look at what we've done. Look at what we've made. Look at all of these amazing things." But he answered them, "You see all these things, do you? Truly I say to you, there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." They went out to the Mount of Olives and they sat there, and it says that the disciples came to him privately saying, "Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?" And then Jesus goes on and teaches about it. Again, you could read this for yourself this week, Matthew chapter 24 and 25. What we want to look at today is a part of that, a story, a parable that Jesus told about the end. And he said, the kingdom of heaven is like this wedding feast. There were these 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. In those days, you got ready for marriage differently than we do today. In those days, engagement was tantamount to being married. That was already the legal commitment. That's why Joseph, when he was betrothed, engaged to Mary, to break that was going to have to get a divorce. And so what would happen in those days is you would become engaged. That's the legal commitment. And then at some time, some indeterminate time, the bridegroom would come and he'd gather friends and neighbors and people and come together and take his bride and go to his home, and they would have a celebration. And so these 10 virgins in the story are going out to meet the bridegroom that they expect to come soon. The 10 virgins, it says 5 of them were foolish, 5 were wise. The word here for foolish, Pastor Sutton, I know, used this in Bible study the other week, is morons. And I think he wasn't calling the Bible study students morons, but that's the word that's used. So they were foolish. It's interesting, the word for wise. The wise virgins, the word there has to do with practical wisdom. I think too often as Christians we think about the Christian truth as theoretical or not very useful, but this is practical wisdom that the 5 wise virgins had. And it says that they took oil. What we want to see today is that the 10 virgins on the outside were all the same. You might say they were all righteous. We will look at them as religious people. But there were 5 that were empty and 5 that had the oil. We'll look at the oil as we go forward. And so they go out, they fall asleep. This is a picture for death. They all, you know, the story, death comes. But then finally the bridegroom comes. And the bridegroom comes and they hail him. And he takes with him those who were ready, but those who weren't ready, that's the key, those who weren't ready get left behind. As we think about this parable, I want to start here. Jesus says in verse 13, he says, "Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." As we think about the end, we need to make sure that as Christians, we are patiently watching for what might imperil the faith. That we are patiently watching and waiting for the kingdom and for the presence of God in our midst and for his return. Frankly, one of the big problems with the Christian faith is ambivalence. We get distracted. We're just ambivalent. We think life goes on and on, up and down, around and around, and things are going to be about as they always have been, and we don't have to worry about anything. And we find ourselves in this ambivalence and just drift away, especially in America. That's been a problem with the Christian faith, that we just drift away from it. We need to watch for what imperils our faith. Jesus told another story. He told all kinds of stories. He told a story about a sower that went out to sow the seed. You know about that. And some fell on the path and the birds came and ate it. Some fell on the rocky soil. It grew up and then the sun came out and off it went. And then other got sown amidst the weeds and the thistles and it grew up, but all those weeds choked it. We need to be on guard against what imperils the faith. the birds are Satan. Let's be clear on this. Our enemy is not flesh and blood. The enemy of the church is the powers and the principalities. It's Satan himself. And you and I need to be on guard against Satan coming and stealing our faith away. Some fell on the rocky ground and the sun came out. That's a picture for perils and trouble, tribulation, persecution. We're living during a time of tribulation. I don't know that it has amounted to persecution yet, but certainly these are difficult days for us. And it's easy for us to just drift away, become too concerned with the troubles. And then it says some fell in the thorns and it grew up, and that's the possessions and the things of the world. Here's what I want to say. This world will come to an end. Our lives will come to an end. We need to not drift away. I think about moms and dads. You know, moms and dads, home has become the school these days. Moms and dads, more and more, home needs to become the church. That moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas are doing all that we can to build up our young ones in the Christian faith, because there will come a day for us and for all when this comes to an end. But having said that, let's not think that this is all doom and gloom. Because as we look at this story, we see that a banquet begins at the end. For those who are in Christ, when he comes back again, when he raises us from the dead, it's a celebration, it's a party. How many stories or how many accounts in the scripture have to do with wedding feasts and wedding banquets? John's first sign that he has to do with a wedding. Jesus changes the water into wine. It's a celebration. Think about in Revelation where it says that the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. There was no longer any sea. And John said, and then I saw a new heaven and a new earth coming down out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. Let's be very, very clear on this. Our hope is in a paradise. Our hope is in like a wedding banquet. You've been to a wedding banquet? They're great celebrations. That's the hope. At the end is a great new beginning. This is not about doom and gloom, but it is about being prepared. Jesus came into the world, and he came to a horrible end. He came into this world, and he taught, and he did miracles, and he helped, and then he died. And it was a terrible death. It was a horrible death, death by crucifixion. He poured out his blood on the cross, and it looked like the end. But that end served as the great beginning of the new heaven and the new earth, where Jesus promises to come and to save us. Jesus says, in my Father's house are many rooms. If it weren't so, I would have told you. But I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come back and take you to be with me so that you also may be where I am. As we think about the end, let's be clear. It is coming. There will come a day. But for those who are in Christ, it will be a day of great celebration. We would hate for it to be a half-filled wedding. That's what the story was. It was a half-filled wedding. Five didn't, five did. We're living in times of half-filled weddings. It is the work of the church to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, that more might hear and that more might believe. William Willimon was the campus pastor at Duke. Maybe he still is, but he's written all kinds of books and just a terrific writer. And he wrote about a time when he was a young pastor in Georgia, and one of his members' uncles died, and he decided that he and his wife should go to the funeral. And so it says, Willimon and his wife drove to a backwoods off-brand Baptist church for the funeral one sunny afternoon. It was, Willimon said, unlike anything he had ever seen. They wheeled the casket in, and soon thereafter the pastor began to preach. With great fire and flailing of his arms all over the place, the pastor thundered, "It's too late for Joe. He might have wanted to do this or that in his life, but it's too late for him now.
He's dead. It's all over. He might have wanted to straighten out his life, but he can't now. It's finished. As Willimon sat there, he thought to himself, well, this is certainly a great comfort to the grieving family. And then the minister continued, but it ain't too late for you. People drop dead every day, so why wait? Too late for Joe, but not for you. Make your life count. Wake up and come to Jesus now. Well, Willimon concluded, it was the worst thing I had ever heard. He said, can you imagine a preacher doing that to a bereft family? He asked his wife on the car on the way home. I've never heard anything so manipulative, cheap, and inappropriate. I would never preach a sermon like that. His wife agreed. It was tacky, calloused, and manipulative. And of course, his wife added, the worst part is that everything he said is true. We need to be on guard, and we want to wait, and we want to watch. We don't know when that day will come. That day will give way to a glorious day, and we would hate to miss that. Well, what makes the difference? Jesus talked in this story about the oil. The five had oil, and the five didn't. What is the oil? It says, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. In the Old Testament, oil is used as a staple of covenant relationship. Not petroleum oil, but olive oil. And it's used in all of the covenantal relationship kinds of things. Oil is used in the lamps, in the tabernacle, and in the temple. Oil was used for anointing different things. It was used for healing. Oil was used to anoint King David. Samuel anointed David with oil to be the new king of Israel. And the next statement is, the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. What is the oil? The oil is, we can say, true faith. The oil is true relationship with God in Jesus Christ. The oil is to be filled with the Holy Spirit as the Spirit comes to us in baptism. It's not that shell of outward religiousness, like that oil lamp. You know, the oil lamp that's empty is that outward sign of religiousness. But it's when we're filled with oil, when we're filled with the presence and the love that God has for us in Jesus Christ, that's how we can be sure that we're safe with Him. Jesus said in this parable, He said, afterward, the other virgins came along saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered, truly I say to you, I do not know you. There was another time that Jesus said something like that, truly I never knew you. This is from Matthew chapter 7. It says, on that day many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to you, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father. What is the will of the Father? How can we be sure that we're safe with God when Jesus returns? What is the will of the Father? This is from John chapter 6. Jesus says, for this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. The world didn't come to an end this last week. The sun came up today. Odds are it'll come up tomorrow. But there will come a day when it doesn't. There will come a day when life in this world, our life, comes to an end. That's not to be a frightening thing. That's not to be something that would cause us anxiety, but that we would have hope and confidence in the love that God has for us in Jesus Christ, so that when he comes, when he returns, he will welcome us into that banquet feast that has no end. May God keep us safe in that faith until that great day. Amen. Having heard God's word, I want to invite you to rise and we'll proclaim our faith. We speak the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Very God, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again. Ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in the Holy Christian. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The congregation may be seated. I want to say again good morning and welcome to those who are worshiping here at Meridian Campus and for those who are joining us online. We pray God, and he will, to continue to see us through difficult days. There's been an uptick in the virus and other concerns across our land. We've made our way through an election. That's a good thing. But God continues to watch over and will protect us. I do want to remind you, we are going to do a Thanksgiving basket distribution on November 21. If you'd like to sign up and help, send us a note here at the church. We are planning Thanksgiving Eve services. And this is what we have in mind. We will have an in-person worship at Christ Campus at 12:15, or I guess it's at 12 o'clock at Christ Campus. And then we want to try a drive-in service here at the Meridian Campus. We're going to get an FM broadcaster, and we've got some things we have in mind so that you'd come and park in the parking lot. We'll get out a little bit, but we want to have a drive-in Thanksgiving Eve worship service. Also, we'd ask that you'd bring some groceries for that, and we'll pass those on to the food bank. We'll get you more information about that as we get a little closer. We also have a voters meeting on November 30. We do plan to have that, we'll deliver that by Zoom. That's going to be an update on our succession planning. We're not making a decision on that, but just some further information and some other items that we will talk about in that. So look forward to that. We'll get you some more information. And just so you know, we are watching the uptick in the virus, and we're trying to figure out what that means or doesn't mean in the life of the congregation. I think we're pretty well spread out. We'll see how 11 o'clock service goes and still deliver service online. But we'll continue. We want to be good citizens, but we also want to continue in Christian fellowship. So we'll work our way through this. Let me invite you to rise. Let's prepare for prayer.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you've called us to watch for you, Give us your Holy Spirit so that we can be patient and watchful while we wait for your coming. Fix our eyes on you, on your empty tomb, and on your return. Lord, in your mercy, most merciful God, we pray that you would guide your church so that we can be patient. And as we patiently wait for you, that we can proclaim your word to all people. Grant us your Holy Spirit so that we can indeed be bold and faithful in our proclamation. Lord, we thank you and praise you as we celebrate the anniversary of St. Luke's founding. Lord, as you have over these many years, continue to bless this congregation with your presence and your sustaining grace. Lord, in your mercy, precious Jesus, conform us to live and to love like you. Lord, we ask that we as brothers and sisters in your name could be transformed so that we can live in unity and lead others to your peace. Lord, we ask that you would be with our country, be with our communities, be with our neighborhoods, be with our cities. And Lord, let us experience Sabbath rest and peace in you. Lord, we thank you for veterans, those who have served us in our country. As we celebrate Veterans Day this week, let us recall the work that you have done in and through these individuals and their sacrifices. Lord, in your mercy, Lord God, grant health, wisdom, and integrity to all in authority over us. We especially pray for our current president, President Trump, as well as President-elect Biden. Lord, we pray for all newly elected leaders, as well as those presently serving in various capacities in our community, state, nation, and around the world. Lord, in your mercy, Holy Lord, be with all who are troubled, all who are in need, those who are sick or struggling. We lift up those who are ill and recovering from illness and surgery. We especially pray for Tim. And we pray for those who will be having surgery this week. We especially pray for Nancy and Sue. Lord, we also pray for the family and friends of Kay, Darius McAvoy's mother, as she passed away earlier this week. Give them and all of us courage to stand firm until the day of your return. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we now ask that you would hear our own prayers and petitions that we offer up to you. Lord, in your mercy, we pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our service.
Thank you for joining us for worship this morning. We pray God's blessings on you during the course of this week. We're grateful that we're able to stay connected through the technology during these days. Here at the sanctuary now, we're going to continue with Holy Communion. If you'd like to receive Holy Communion as a family unit or individually, feel free to call the church and make an appointment, and we'd be glad to include you in a communion devotional setting. As we go on our way, we pray this is 2020, that we continue to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. The Lord does bless and will always keep you. The Lord's face is shining on you. He will be good and gracious to you. The Lord looks on you with his favor, and in Jesus, he gives you peace. Amen.